You listen to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And no, if you're watching the video version, this isn't some sort of fantastical dream that's happening. My guest camera doesn't work, so we'll have fun. I mean, I'm not going to look. I'm looking directly at the camera anyway, so I'm not going to see it. So it's everyone else is watching that's going to have the issue if they do have any. But if you do,
just
listen to it. Listen to the audio. Yeah. Go to Spotify. Oh, good.
I will put my hands up. I am going to be totally honest. If anything has gone wrong, it will almost definitely be my fault. I am the most tech illiterate person in the world.
Oh, watch this. This is episode 298, I think, of 297. And I only found out today that I could probably put a watermark on these videos. So that just speaks to how tech savvy I am in this. But you've heard his voice. You've seen the title of the video or audio. I'm joined by, I don't know if he's still called the best young wrestler, but he will be on this occasion in this dreamland. It is Lewis Girvan. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me. I think you're being immensely, immensely generous to call me that, but I appreciate it all the same.
I think you're still younger than me, so I think that's counts for nothing, really. But
got 30 creeping up. It's getting there.
Oh, I just passed 34. And what they don't tell you is, once you hit 34, it was the day after, my body just went, no, that's it. You like having three monsters a day. No, you're not having that anymore. You'll have two and then have heart palpitations later. That's what you'll have instead. God, my body hates me. But anyway, yes, you've been a guest I've wanted to have on for a long time. I just finally got up the wherewithal to go, you know what, what if I just message him? Instagram seems to be the new cool place to get guests. Mm-hmm. So finally got it set up. We're here. We've got about near 15 years of questions and opponents that I've got a note of on my big A4 pad here. So we'll try and touch upon them as we go. But in the meantime, because it's your first time on the podcast, you've got to be asked the most boring wrestling question and the most cliched question. How did you become a fan of pro wrestling?
So, the same answer as my brother, who you've had on. It was late 2007. My brother and I had always been like aware of wrestling, but it was just not something we ever took much of an interest in. And then our mum at the time worked in Blockbuster, which some people might remember. And because of that, she could rent stuff for free. And Fraser and I, just always wanting a game to play with nothing else to get, he got the WWE game that came out at the time, which would have been SmackDown vs. Raw 2008. And not out of any real interest other than, that looks slightly more interesting than whatever else they might have had at the time. And so he was playing it, and I did the very big brotherly thing of going, that looks quite fun, so I'm going to take it off him. And just from there, it was from playing the game to then our dad noticing that we'd kind of developed a keen interest in. He was always really good for kind of encouraging like the things we took an interest in. So he found out that there was a catch-up show for WWE on Sky One, WWE Experience on a Sunday morning. So he would record that for us that we would watch. And for like the first year, that was us. And it was then an advert in a paper advertising a local show. And I was maybe 13 at the time. And that was the first time it ever really occurred to me that, there's actually probably also wrestling here, which had just never really occurred to me before.
I'm finding, like, the more I'm doing these interviews, that I'm finding that there's a definite like change in, like, when you hit 30. Like, everyone that's before 30, pre-30, seemed to get into the wrestling through the video games or through magazines or whatever, and then post-30, it's wrestling channel or that, and then the older you get, the more retro it becomes, whether it's tape trading or the guy down the street who can get this guy onto your TV for nothing kind of thing. You know, it's a big divide. So the video games, if you went back and played the old, your video game guy, are you? Or
I am.
You
are,
so if you went back to the ones before,
absolutely. Like, around about the time we get into the game, I just became voracious for anything wrestling I could get my hands on. And it's funny you say about how people get into wrestling, because I think that kind of mid-ish to late 2000s into even the early 2010s, like, social media and YouTube really wasn't as, at least certainly for wrestling content specifically, not as readily accessible as it obviously is now. But we were kind of just sort of out of that sort of old enough to have caught it on the telly at any point. And so going back and playing all the old games was my way of just kind of immersing myself in it. I just wanted to know everything, you know. I really wanted to just consume as much wrestling as I could. I wanted to know who everybody was. I wanted to know what titles they won. I wanted to know all the best matches. And the games for me were like a huge, huge kind of like gateway to that.
It's when you go into, I'm going to show my age here, when you go into like Woolies or anything like that, and you go to the DVD section, you see a new one that's like a fiver, and you go, oh, it's wrestling. Oh, yeah, I'm going to buy that anyway. I still remember, I've got somewhere in my parents' loft, is the John Cena Word Life DVD, the orange cover one, because I went in and it was $4.99. I was like, yeah, I'm going to buy that. I'll probably never watch it, but you know, I've got to grab everything I possibly can. It's nowadays, my wife's finding that for her thing was Nightmare Before Christmas. And it's kind of same thing when you say immersing. But nowadays, well, when she was younger, you couldn't find anything. Nightmare Before Christmas, nothing at all. And nowadays it's like Asda, I've got shelves and shelves of the stuff. And she's like buying everything just in case the sky falls and it never happens again. Mm-hmm. So I'm still the same with wrestling now, 34. If I go into a shop and I see something wrestling related, I'm like, oh, I should probably buy that just in case I never see it again, which explains the big wall of crap
a little bit,
because I'm like, never know, I may never see a British Bulldog pop in the shops ever again. I'll just buy it now just in case. So you went back. Who was your guys before you even saw them wrestle then, when you went back to these games, like, I don't know, see the Headbangers, you were like, oh man, the Headbangers are amazing, but never actually seeing them wrestle till later on?
Well, the first ones that really jumped out to me were, I think it really speaks to how, like, when you're in wrestling or out of wrestling, people who resonate with you will do so regardless, because a lot of the guys I really gravitated towards early on were guys I'm still fans of now. I make no secret of the fact Undertaker, from the day I get into wrestling to right now, is my favourite wrestler. And that's been a pretty much a constant. CM Punk, the Hardy Boys, just those were the ones that I noticed playing those initial games. Those are the ones that, going back, and even as stuff has progressed, are people that I've always really enjoyed watching and at times playing as.
I feel like you're hiding, though. There must be an embarrassing one. Must be one that you're looking going, Al Snow. You know, just one that you loved for no other reason than you just did.
So, just because he had such a cool and weird entrance, when I would go back and play SmackDown versus Raw, I would say 2007, it had to be the Boogeyman, because I think it speaks a lot to like the 13-year-old boy mind that I thought him smashing a clock on his head in time with his pyro. I was like, well, that's the coolest thing ever. Like, that's what every wrestler should be trying to do.
That is a great choice. Yeah. No, even now, I'm still impressed, because when you watch Tough Enough and he seems so uncoordinated, and even the wrestling ring, he seems so uncoordinated, yet he always got that clock on his head, bang on when the pyro went off. It's like that was his one chance to get his timing right, and then the rest of it was just hope for the best, ripping off growths off faces and stuff.
Well, he had this... he had a finish when it was like the World's Strongest Slam, but the other way around. And again, it goes a lot. It's like, see if you're like a step removed from like being in wrestling. Like, I remember as the kid going, oh, that must absolutely kill you. That must be like so painful. And it's a move that I cannot actually recall anyone else ever really doing. So maybe you get a couple of things right. Maybe I knew what it was on about.
Maybe is that one of those moves though that you look at it and go, Fraser, I want to show you something. Come here.
I knew my brother was growing up when we used to play wrestle in the room, and I used to always try and give him the attitude adjustment. And I used to, at one point, be strong enough that I could like cradle him from my shoulders all the way to the floor. And when the day finally came, that I was like, he's getting a wee bit heavy for this. That's when I was like, yeah, we're not playing wrestling anymore. This isn't fun.
No, you could beat me now. Let's just lay that to rest. So, video games, when you got into it, you finally saw there was some wrestling live. Was that you said it was an indie show? Do you remember who was on it? Anyone in particular that you remember on that show?
See, that's the craziest thing. It's just I just remember seeing it, and then my mum and dad going, "Oh, we can't go. There was X thing on," but it planted the seed in my head. It's like, okay, there's that means it's here. You know, that means there's people around that do it. And so I fell down a bit of a rabbit hole again. Wrestling on the internet was fairly rudimentary at the time. I remember I just Googled Scottish wrestling. And at the time, Scottish Wrestling Alliance was the first thing that popped up. And they had a school only about 10 minutes from my house. And it was I actually started training before I'd ever seen a show, WWE or indie.
Sorry, my brain's just kind of broke for a moment there. So you actually started training without ever actually seeing wrestling live. Well, no, I suppose, no, I was thinking that's silly, but you would have had the WWE experience, stuff like that. So you would have seen wrestling. You just wouldn't have seen it in person yet. That's not as crazy.
Well, I'd never seen it live, but the WWE experience was just a highlight. So I'd actually started training before I'd ever seen a full match in its entirety.
That is madness. And considering what you've accomplished since then, that's just it must be a fairly unique story, I would think. I've done near 300 episodes of that, and generally everyone has seen a full match before they consider doing wrestling. So SWA is where you started then, at a very prestigious school. I mean, it's no longer it went into Source, and it's been moved into GPWA, which is where you are now. So you're still there. In some sort of spirit. What do you remember about your first training sessions?
So it coincided quite nicely that around about within a couple of weeks of my first week training was a Big Demo, his first week as the head coach of the school, more or less. A lot of the top guys at the time were busy with like real life stuff, and so it was going to basically come to be that no one was going to be able to run the school formally. And so God bless Damo. He'll be the first one to say he was 24 years old, had only been wrestling about 4 years himself, and all of a sudden he found himself effectively solely in charge of this wrestling school. And so I remember him being quite stern at first, probably no small part going, I don't have a clue what I'm doing, can't let anyone know. But like a lot of names that I would have worked with early on were people like Nikki Cross, who would obviously go on to do very well. I distinctly remember the very first thing I ever did on my first day was like a small cardio drill, which is a 13-year-old that had never played a sport more than about 10 minutes of football. It was quite tough. But it was Dickie Divers I actually did it with, I'll always remember.
And again, Dickie Divers is another one that's still going strong in the like Dundee and Angus area as well. 13, though, that must be quite daunting. I mean, I suppose you're going in with actually no expectation other than seeing some highlights and playing the video games, so you're not seeing the big injuries, bar maybe if you're able to catch a Botchamania in its infancy. So like what did you expect when you went there?
So when I first started, I really had no expectations. Like, it was a bit of a running joke amongst my friends at school at the time. Everyone kind of had a thing that they did, which will sound silly, but like I had a friend who was like a young actor and he'd been in like a couple episodes of Still Game. I had another friend who was like in a band, and even at like 11, 12, he'd already played the ABC. So it was people that did quite well in these like various things they did. And truth be told, like I tried a bit of everything. You know, I tried playing in a band. Turns out I have got less than zero musical talent. I tried playing other sports, and the beauty of wrestling is you can hide how uncoordinated you are, but I didn't quite have that grace anywhere else. I mean, I even tried ballet for about a day, and I went, this is really hard, I'm not doing this anymore. And so, yeah, no, just kind of in the pursuit of, like, something that I enjoyed, something that I could kind of call my own, I kind of found wrestling by accident. And those first few months of training were just me going, oh, I think I seem to have a bit of an aptitude for this, you know, like, I really enjoy it, it's fun. I'm enjoying, like, if you ask anyone from back then, they'll tell you that I was, like, the most quiet little wallflower ever. But, like, I enjoyed being around people who had the same kind of keen interest in this thing that I did. Because back then it wasn't cool to be into wrestling. Like, there was no one I went to school with that watched it or, God forbid, even talked about it. So getting to kind of be quite open about liking wrestling was nice. But, yeah, no, I was training about 6 months before I had, like, the moment that made me go, oh, this is the thing that I want to do.
I mean, you're absolutely right with the... You've always given off the appearance to me anyway that you're quite an introverted person, and I kind of get that because I'm very much the same. I mean, we're doing this Zoom chat now. We're very chatty. I mean, we've met at shows very briefly, and I can tell you it's probably some of the most awkward interactions from an outside perspective to watch, because it's the same with me and Aspen. It's like we can chat back and forth on social media, but if we meet face-to-face, it's just like,
hello.
Hello.
Nah.
Good match. I better go home now. That's pretty much it. The show's just started. I better go find my seat then. And I'll catch you later. But yeah, you've always kind of given that vibe away from it. And the fact that the boogeyman has been one that you kind of drawn yourself to, that's such a, like, chalk and cheese comparison, especially for someone who was very good at hiding their limitations, as you've kind of alluded to for what wrestling's like. So it's very interesting that you brought up the boogeyman when I pressed you further for some cringeworthy wrestlers that you enjoyed.
If you want a funny example of that, Damo gave me the most backhanded compliment I think I've ever received. He said, every trainee I've had come through the school that's gone on to do relatively well have all been, like, good athletes, you know, they've excelled in other sports. Except for you, Lewis. And I was like, thanks, Damo. I know what you mean, but phrasing stung just a touch there.
You're rubbish at everything, but you're quite a good wrestler. That's high five.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I've had Damo on this podcast before. It was ages ago, so I cannot remember anything about it. But I'm sure I remember him saying either pre or post record that, yeah, he was kind of thrown into the deep end. And do you think him being in that position, like you said, he was a bit harsher, maybe he was a bit more like maybe not aggressive, but like he was panicking, maybe, that everyone had to be safe and do well and be able to learn, and he's sitting there going, I don't know what I'm doing either. Do you think that helped you? Did you find that more, like, push towards getting things right was better for you to develop so quickly?
I do think so. I think Damo deserves a lot of credit as a coach in a lot of ways, not only for what he knew he could do, but I think the underrated element is what he knew he couldn't do. He knew that he was relatively inexperienced at, you know, 4 years in. And so the best thing he did, and this is a sentiment he shared with me as well, is that he was smart enough to go, I need better people here, not just so that everyone else can learn how to be better trainees, but so I can be a better coach. And so he would bring in Johnny Moss and Fergal Devitt and Paul Tracy, just to name a few of the very earliest that I remember seeing. And these are, like, obviously super high-level guys that really forced us to be better, because back then, especially as wrestling got more and more and more popular, it was very much you kind of had to rise to the level of expectations, especially if it's someone like, say, Johnny Moss, who's obviously now a coach in NXT. He had the same standards then as I'm sure he does now, and they're going to be the absolute highest, and it's your job to meet those. It's not his job to lower them. And so, I think Damo did a really, really good job of setting us all up to succeed. And no small part of that was him going, I've kind of been thrown out the deep end myself. I need to figure it out. And part of that is getting these people who've been there and done that in for all of our benefit.
I mean, I remember when I started watching, started getting involved in just immersing myself in Scottish wrestling was about 2012. But I'd always see on Facebook or maybe a bit of Bebo, I can't remember the timeline exactly, but I'd always see SWA would have, like, some mad seminar. Like, once a month there would be someone from, I don't know, 01 or something, a name I've never heard of. So I've had to go to YouTube because I don't know. I still don't know much about Japanese wrestling, perfectly honest, but the name never heard of. I'll go check and go, oh my God, this guy's just leathered someone to bits, but he's getting these massive praises for it. Ultimo Dragon, I remember Ultimo Dragon being one that popped up, and it's just, yeah, just that sentiment. And the fact that he did all that, Demo was either in charge or co-charge of SWA for years. And then when he finally kind of let go of the reins a little bit, what, a year later, if that, he was in NXT and doing all that sort of stuff. So it showed how much maybe he was holding on to it before he finally just dove into the deep end again.
I think that's probably another example of him being smart enough to know what he can do and know what he can't do. That was him going that his wrestling career was really, really starting to pick up, and that's, you know, a testament to his work and his talent. He could have, if he really wanted to, really tried to like stick it out, running the school and running the company. But that was going to be like one foot in each. So he was really, really smart and mature enough to go, I'm going to put my 100% into me because I have other trusted individuals I can hand this off to who I know are going to like run with it. I think at all points, Demo's self-awareness has been one of his greatest assets. And that's kind of shown in his track record. You know, the sheer amount of people that he has produced that have gone on to do amazing things. Don't quote me on the math, but I would wager the sheer amount of people that came from Source that have gone on to WWE in some capacity or another has got to put it as one of the best turnouts of schools possibly in the world.
Just trying to think that off the top of my head. And yeah, I mean, just to think a few names off the top of my head. I mean, mentioned Nikki, Joe Hendry, started there. Coffees started there. Demo himself, he kind of
Piper Niven, Isla Dawn.
It's an amazing track record when you come to think of it. Probably going to spend the rest of my week just like maybe just going through just to kind of tally just for my own curiosity. Mm-hmm. But that's an incredible run that Demo's and he doesn't brag about it. He's very humble.
Absolute last guy to ever brag about it, despite being one of the guys who has the most reason to brag about it.
I mean, Demo himself, we'll get into it a little bit later on, but he was behind the eventual Kings of Catch as well, because he just pestered you into a tag team. So he's also given rise to probably one of my favourite tag teams in Scottish wrestling. Unfortunately, until Skull Brawl. I think it was Aspen. I was just a fan of Aspen, but Kings of Catch were there for a long time. they were there for a long time. I've still got pictures of you somewhere.
I do not blame you. I do not blame you. I really enjoy what Aspen and Caleb are doing as well. You know, I think it's they've become a really good team, and I think it's a credit to Aspen's creativity that it's a team that bears no resemblance to him and I, you know, in the same way that he and I bore virtually no resemblance to Team Smash that he'd been in previously.
Very true. Yeah. So, this isn't the Aspen talk, even though I probably could speak about Aspen for an hour very easily. I mean, you could probably just sit back in silence and I'll do it myself, but we won't do that. So I've got noted in Cage Match, my Bible for matches, that your debut was 2010 in one of the Battle Zones. Was that the case?
It was, yeah. Excellent. It was originally supposed to be earlier, but I believe I was on like a family holiday, which you can imagine how 15-year-old me was like, but do I have to go? Because I could be on the Bishopton Gala Day.
Was 15, did you feel ready at 15 to do it?
I do. I did, sorry. The truth is like, I started training in the October of 2008, and it got to like the May, June of 2010. And so while obviously I was still super young, I had definitely put in what was, at least at that point, above average time for getting a debut. Like, there was folk who'd started the same day as me and even since that had been on shows. And I figured that my age was a factor. But in one of my braver moments earlier, and I just went up to Demo and the other coaches at the time, I was like, could I debut? I thought maybe I was missing something. And it was just more of a, yeah, actually, you could. It was just because, like I say, I was so quiet. I was so just there, just politely, you know, going about my business, that they kind of went, oh, wait, no, that's right. Lewis has been here for, you know, a year and a half plus at this stage. So there's absolutely no reason why he couldn't, you know, do a gala day or something like that. And so, yeah, from there, it was the Battle Zone, July 3rd, 2010. It was my first ever match.
Yeah. I mean, it won't make a difference to your life, but that was the day after my 20th birthday. There you go. Right. So I'm just looking to see who was in this match. And my God, Eric Canyon won the match, but you got BT Gunn in there, Damo himself, Divers, a young man called Grant Dunbar. Wonder what ever happened to him.
Yeah.
We've got Red Lightning, Liam Thompson, my word, and Nathan Black, who came and went so quickly, but he looked incredible. Was this the point where were you got a thing when it comes to Rumble matches, that a strategy, so to speak, for Rumble matches? Mm-hmm. Was this the one you unleashed the initial plan? When did you realize that the low blow-a-thon was the best course forward for Rumble matches? I don't think you've actually won it. I just realized.
No. It's a very effective strategy for keeping people down, but in terms of getting them over the top rope, I've yet to crack that particular chestnut, I'm afraid. I can keep Rumbles going. I just can't finish them.
I feel like that's your video game side of you going, like you probably did it in Rumbles with Fraser when you're playing the games, going, I'm going to make this last as long as possible. I'm just going to kick you in the nuts until I decide to finally throw you over. Feels like that kind of vibe.
I wish I could say it was like that. Honestly, it was one of those like weird moments of serendipity. So towards the tail end of 2014, I started coaching at Source. And it's 99% of the time, at least certainly back at that point, your first match on a show probably would be a Rumble or a Battle Royal. And so I tend to find that good practice of that is necessary because it's a totally different kind of idea to a normal match. It's less to remember, sure, it's less focus individually on you, but the first thing that happens is people will slide in and there'll be a real deer caught in headlights because they don't know what to do. And so it was through practicing Rumbles, kind of more just as a way to amuse myself, I started doing it. But then I noticed that everyone else in the room would laugh when I started doing it. And I'm a big, big believer. It's like, see if you can find an organic reaction like that to something. That made me go, I think there might be something to this. And so it was the Square Go 2015, if you can believe, was the first time I did a few. And after like the third or fourth, I definitely heard like a murmuring of laughter. And I was like, okay, so there's definitely something to this. And so, yeah, for the longest time, that just became my go-to in Battle Royals or Rumbles of any kind, because technically speaking, can't be disqualified. And it makes total sense because it gives me a chance to catch my breath.
There you go. We won't go too far into the weeds in 2010 and moving on, but I just saw your first singles match noted here is with a guy called The Machine. And I thought, yes, I would click onto that link and see if there's any other aliases for The Machine. And what do you know, it's apparently Bonesaw. So I don't know if you're aware of that, if it actually was Bonesaw. Was it?
It was not. No, it was not Bonesaw. It was, I don't know if it's for me to say, actually, because it's so funny you bring it up. It makes me go, has it ever been publicly said who was The Machine? I should say this. A lot of folk have worn that mask over the years.
Right.
But the person I was with is someone who deserves a lot of credit for getting a very scared, nervous 15-year-old through his first singles match on a show.
I mean, if I remember, I'll ask you after the recording who it was, just for my own curiosity's sake. Anyway, so yeah, I was just going through your first year, and the names that I'm seeing here, you're Joe Coffey, a young man called Mark Anthony, who may have become Mark Coffey, like Scott Rennick, Glenn DeBar, of course. I saw Black Samurai Jr., and that made me laugh when I saw it. But I'm going to jump ahead quite a little bit here into to 2013 or so, because again, when I'm looking at matches, I'm thinking, oh my God, look at this list of opponents that you had. In that 3-year period, I mean, this is before you started coaching, was the best young wrestler name, was that thing? Who called you it, or did you call it yourself one day and it stuck? Where did that come from?
So I started calling myself that about 2015, I want to believe. So it was a wee bit later. The whole reason was is like the big critique of me as a performer for a long time was how kind of quiet and reserved I was, even in a kind of performance capacity. So for me, it's just I felt so frustrated because I felt like I put all this work into the more physical aspect of what I did in the ring. And I can say now as like a more mature person that I should have had a better balance at the time. But it's like, you know, a 20-year-old full of piss and vinegar, I just really wanted to emphasize it's like when it comes to an actual wrestling capacity, I do believe I'm as good as anyone. And I want to remind folk that even though I've been around at that point for a few years, I'm still one of, if not the youngest person in any given locker room at the time. And so that name was really born out of a lot of frustration with my position and wanting to remind people just what I thought of myself at the time, really.
What you mentioned a lot about you being quiet and introverted and all that kind of stuff. How, because even as from a wrestler standpoint, as a character for initially, you were just a very good wrestler who did a very good wrestling. How did you kind of try and manage kind of just unleashing a little bit more character? Was there anything you were consciously doing or watching to try and create a bit more of a character other than good wrestler?
I think there's two people who deserve a lot of credit for it. The first was Lionheart. I had kind of been struggling to find a place on the card in ICW for a few years as a bad guy. And it was in this early 2016, I became a good guy against him. And he was just kind of like the perfect foil for me to show fire and determination. And just like, he was such a good bad guy that it made it much easier for me to show being a good guy. And so I think that really helped me find that nuance and the difference. Because before that, I would play very much in the black and the whites as opposed to any shade of grey in the middle. And I think that the shades of grey in the middle is where a lot of the best character work is, because it's so much more true to life, and that makes it easier for people to form an emotional attachment to it. You know, like the brief rundown of the story at the time was the Black Label was the big bad guy group. I'm this young wrestler I desperately want to be in. I want the approval of Drew and Jester and everyone else. And so when they kept pushing me out, eventually my frustrations boiled over, and that's a natural reaction that I think anyone could relate to, and Lionheart was just the perfect foil, like I say. I think the next person who deserves a lot of credit is Aspen, actually. When he and I started teaming, it was the first time I ever had another person to bounce off of a lot, and I think that kind of helped me show a lot more of like my very dry sense of humor, you know, the sarcasm and the stuff like that, like Filth Life, which became King's Road, that we did, helped. That let he and I show that we do have a sense of humor and that we do have a personality. It's just maybe not as overt or in your face as other people on shows at the time might have been. But that didn't mean that we couldn't also kind of carve out our own little niche of the audience, which we did. So yeah, in terms of like transitioning from just a straight-laced wrestler into having the facet to be more of a performer and a character, it was definitely working with Lionheart and Aspen that really, really helped me in that regard.
I do remember the Filth Life stuff. Considering Aspen's kind of stoicness, kind of characterness, when he's the goofy one out of the tandem, yeah. I really enjoyed the Filth Life stuff and the things that came out of it as well. And it was a good laugh for 5 minutes of the day, and you're just shouting Aspen constantly. Always made it worthwhile. So we'll scale back to 2013 again, because I wrote down two opponents specifically. One being Chuck Taylor for SWA. Yeah. So of course he's just, I think he may have just about retired. I think he's injured at the
just
moment
recently.
To AEW.
Yeah.
But even then, I didn't know a lot about independent wrestling, but I certainly knew the name of Chuck Taylor. So I don't know where you were of Chuck Taylor when you were told or knew that this match was coming up, but how was that experience for you?
So that was one of the first times where I was really like almost like overwhelmed by the weight of the moment, which sounds silly, but it's like I say, we didn't have Sky Sports, so our exposure to wrestling was very, very limited. And one of the few things that we had was like what little wrestling there was on YouTube at the time. And there was all the compilations of Chuck Taylor scaring kids. and so he was just one of those first names and faces that I really recognised. And by the time we'd all kind of rolled around to 2013, I'd seen a lot of his work in Shakara, the bits and pieces he'd done with like PWG. And so to me, I was really like, oh my God, you know, like this is a huge, huge opportunity for me. This was one of the first times like I really felt like I was being trusted with like a big, big match. Because say in my first year or two, you named a lot of the people I was really fortunate to work with. There is a degree of that was them helping me get through matches. If someone like Chuck Taylor's brought in, they're not being put on with someone to like get a match out of them. I was very much being expected to at least meet him to a certain degree. And that's the kind of pressure that I would find that I really thrive under. I like that level of pressure. And so getting to work with him, getting to like see that, because this was another thing, is like I've always had quite a bad, was a little bit of imposter syndrome. And so to see someone that's kind of like, at least in my mind at the time, being there and done that, and have it be that we were able to like 50-50 piece a match together, and I really felt like I had like at least one hand on the steering wheel, that was a real moment of affirmation for me, where I feel like, okay, maybe I do actually sort of maybe kind of know what I'm talking about here. And yeah, no, like Chuck Taylor could not have been nicer. Years later, when I would work for Shakara, he would actually recognize me straight away, which always made me laugh, because I was just like, oh, you're like a real wrestler.
Maybe you could have sat there, do 50-50 and thinking, you know what, I think I might be the best young wrestler here. I wonder if that'll come back in 2 years time. Another name that I've got popped up, another one just popped in front of me as well, thanks to the Bible of Cage Match, but I'll mention the one I was thinking of, which is Grado. So one-on-one with Grado at Reservoir Dogs. Which is, of course, you would have had dalliances past him maybe as a young Grant Dunbar and in things like the Square Go as well. But was this your first one-on-one meeting with Grado, and especially in an environment like ICW as well at the time?
Yeah.
That's quite a lot of pressure to put on someone.
Mm-hmm. So he and I had known each other for a few years. Whenever he would have one of his few pop-ins to try a bit of the wrestling again, it would typically always be Source he would come to. So I'd been around him a lot, but you are right in so much as we'd never had a match against one another. Certainly not a one-on-one match in ICW at a time where he was very, very much still in the thick of all that mania that he enjoyed for so many years. And so it was someone got injured the night before. And so I was very much a last-minute replacement. And I think being a last-minute replacement was almost like a blessing in disguise, because, I mean, I didn't have an opportunity to overthink it. Mm-hmm. Grado will never give himself enough credit for how good a wrestler he is. He will always, always defer to whoever he's working with. And so kind of like similar to the Chuck Taylor thing, having like feeling like I'm helping piece together a match with someone that looks to me as something of a peer, I think all of that together did a lot to really help quell my nerves. And he could not have been more gracious. Like there was a small thing in the match where I hit him a little bit harder than intended. And I've always kind of prided myself in being like safe with the people that I work with. And he could not have been more like, don't worry about it. These things happen. And little things like that, I think, go a long way in helping younger wrestlers really feel like, oh, it's okay. Like I don't need to be as at 11 all the time about everything. These things happen. It's just a natural course of the job.
Grado's definitely one of those guys where he gives, I mean, I've had him on the podcast as well, but that was a very chaotic episode for having at the time I had like a 4-month-old and he was crying in this room, and the time ticked over for the meeting for the interview to start. So I kind of left my wife to it, and I've never felt so guilty than I have just going, right, I need to go speak to Grado now. Good luck with that.
Enjoy.
So it was 45 minutes of me panicking that I was going to be absolutely scalped by the time that I come out of that, my recording room. But he always gave off the vibe that Grado comes in with the vibe of get what you want out of wrestling, not have it force itself onto you kind of thing. So whether it's just enjoy it kind of things. And I hope that I'm not wrong in that thought, that he kind of gives that.
No.
It's like it's a wrestling match. It's 20 minutes. People are going to be, well, it's great. It's 5 minutes. It's 10 minutes. Just entertain folk and go home. You know, you don't need to worry about the afterwards and all that kind of stuff. So,
I think Grado is a good example for a lot of wrestlers to look at, because he spent years trying to be a serious wrestler, for lack of a better term. You know, he at one point in his own admission was just trying his best to be Samoa Joe. And Grant Dunbar did not get very far. You know, the things that he got to do are not a shadow to what he did as Grado. And I think that's a good example of, in the right way, he stopped taking himself so seriously. And he just kind of embraced what it was that made him himself and what made him charismatic and magnetic and interesting. And of course, he's gone on to do phenomenally well ever since.
Another match is that I've watched these on full-on on YouTube, is the Scottish Junior Heavyweight Title Tournament, which is 2013 as well. So, you know, opening match, 19th of April 2013, you beat Zack Sabre Jr. Yeah, you just do that. And the semi-final was against Jimmy Meadows, and then you're in the final, didn't win the match, but you're in the final with Wild Boar. I'm absolutely positive I did watch these during the pandemic, so they'll be somewhere reviewed on the site. But that was a weekend of three matches against, can't remember Jimmy Meadows off the top of my head, but certainly two different, very different opponents in Wild Boar and Zack Sabre Jr. And this was before the match with Grado the month before. If there's ever a moment for imposter syndrome to strike and possibly to your detriment, was that the moment where that was the month after Chuck Taylor as well. So geez, that's 3 months and you're facing four of the biggest names in independent wrestling, you know, not to put slight to Jimmy Meadows, but you know, that's a pretty big load of matches over a course of 3 months. So how was the tournament for you in that 2 days?
Intense, I think is probably the right word. Like I said, before and during wrestling Chuck, I found that I like being the guy where it's like, Lewis, we need 15, 20, 25 minutes, we need a good match, you know, and we need you to like really physically go for it. That's the spot I absolutely love being in. So see, getting to have like a one-on-one match with Zack Sabre, who even at that point was doing phenomenal work in pro wrestling NOAH and around Europe as well. It was a real test. It was a real push, you know, like to hear someone who is physical. And I say this in the best possible way. It's like, he knows how good he is, and it is very much your job to keep up with him. And I absolutely relished that. You know, that was, you know, precisely the kind of challenge I needed and wanted at the time. And it was definitely one of my very best matches for a long time. Jimmy Meadows, who you mentioned, he was Robbie Brookside's protege. Robbie Brookside, who's obviously now a coach at NXT. He wrestled Ryback on SmackDown once. So... Jimmy Meadows did quite well for himself.
Where's Ryback now? Well,
tell me about it.
I know.
And then, you know, the match with Wild Boar was personally really important to me as well, because that was the first time I was ever in a singles match in the main event of a show. And that was a responsibility that wasn't lost on me. That was an opportunity that Damo gave me that really, like, personally meant a lot, you know, because, like I say, when I get into wrestling, I had, like, no expectations, but I found very quickly it was the first thing in my life that I felt good about myself, because it was the first kind of like source of self-esteem I'd ever had. And so to be able to go from that to then just a few short years later feeling like, oh, I've been put in like a real position of expectation and responsibility. You know, the last match on a show is the last impression you're leaving an audience with. It's your job to make sure that if and when the time comes, those people are going to want to put their money down again. And so to do that and to get to do it with someone as good as Wild Boar was even all those years ago, which is really, really cool, and it's still something that means a lot to me.
I was just using my amazing skills of typing while looking at the camera, and I just found the review that I did of it. So it was way back in, when did I write it? September 2020. Oh, what a magical time that must have been. But no, it's those shows are really good. I mean, of course, there's some people that you have to watch with a pinch of salt because, you know, of other things. But it was great seeing, go back and watch these shows, especially when it's I think it was Billy Kirkwood and Damo that were on the commentary for those shows as well. So Damo having a vested interest in yourself and everyone that's on the show. I seem to remember he had a lot of just excited to watch wrestling, and because of that, Billy Kirkwood, of course he's going to be hyped to watch wrestling. So they're good shows to go back and watch. So I'd go YouTube, go watch them. They were good fun from what I remember. So that was 2013. You're 3 years into wrestling. Mm-hmm. You're about to start coaching possibly. And before that though, you had Jonathan Gresham in 2014. Yeah. And then you had Zack Sabre again in the same month. That was 2 days. So that was SWA, the War of Independence against Jonathan Gresham. And then the next day it was joint shows with IPW. And you had Zack Sabre. And then you beat Zack Sabre. Has he ever been able to get a win off you? Or has it just all been...
Never, never.
There you go. Zack Sabre in the
match. I'm sure it still haunts him.
I'll tweet him just to make sure. So again, that's two big matches, two technical matches as well. And like you're saying, with you going in with Zack, it's all about keeping up with him. Was Gresham the same in that respect?
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I think I was extremely fortunate that like Zack Sabre and Jonathan Gresham are like big names now, but they were still very, very much on the come up at that point in time. And so they were just as young and as hungry as I was to really like make a point and go out there and show what they could do. The match with Jonathan Gresham, I think, has got to be one of the most important matches I've ever had. Because Alan Smith was in the audience and he, a few months later, would start Discovery Wrestling and he would tell me that it was that match with Gresham that made him want me for Discovery. So that match is something that I still hold very near and dear to my heart. When I most recently saw Gresham earlier this year, I made a point to almost 10 years to the day to go, I hope you know, just like, you know, I owe you a debt I don't think I'll ever be able to repay, because in no small part I can point to that match as kind of like the epicenter for anything and everything I've gone on to do since. Because through that, I got the platform at Discovery, which I think helped showcase me in a different light. I think that kind of bled out into like ICW, a lot of the work I would get to do in England and Ireland. I think really, really all started from there.
That was exactly my next point then, is Discovery Wrestling. 2014, you were part of the initial class to crown the first ever Y Division champion with such names as Damian Daniels. Damian grew a surname for the tournament especially. Ian Ambrose, and you know, just a little wrestler by the name of Chris Sabin, one half of the Motor City Machine Guns. No wonder I've filled a A4 page of notes here where I'm going through the opponents that you faced and been in the ring with. But Chris Sabin, for a guy, a video game guy especially, and a guy that's been able to revisit things on YouTube, and I know that there's hundreds of Motor City Machine Guns compilations even back in 2014, going in with Sabin first in that four-way and then one-on-one. Just, yeah, how did that feel?
To rewind a wee tiny bit to like 2013, I also got to wrestle like Super Crazy and Ultimo Dragon, and so all these like cool folk that I learned so much from. It was such like, and I mean this as sincerely as I can, a real privilege to get to be in there in the ring with, especially like Ultimo Dragon, and I don't think I'm saying anything weird when I say it was more the latter stages of his career, a time where not everyone's going to get to say they wrestled Ultimo Dragon. That was really, really cool. But like, we found this, we being my brother and I, we found TNA was free to watch in the UK. And so we were like, free wrestling every Saturday night for 2 hours. Perfect. You know, so we really threw ourselves into TNA. And Chris Sabin was just one of those names that was always there. They always floated around and he was always exceptional in every role that he was in. And so I don't think it's out with to say that he was one of my favourite wrestlers, certainly maybe even my favourite TNA wrestler. So getting to work with him, not once, but twice, and get to have, again, that kind of that main event singles match, that 20-minute, just leave it all out there style of match, was something that even now I will thank Alan Smith for any time it comes up, because I was 20 years old at the time of the singles match with Sabin, but 19 at the time of the four-way. And I'd been wrestling for a few years, and just that kind of little bit of frustration that I mentioned earlier was starting to creep in. I was like, I just felt like I had the capacity to do more, but I wasn't quite being given the opportunity. And he was one of the first guys out with SWA and Demo to really give me that chance. And he didn't just give me a chance, he gave me two matches for Chris Sabin. And so, yeah, no, that was just, it was a huge, huge honour. Sabin was every bit as good as I knew he was going to be, and then some. And just, again, another guy where it's like, he could have so easily just led me through a match, but the fact that it was, again, a collaborative effort, and I really felt like I was speaking to him peer-to-peer. I distinctly remember a very funny moment of, we come back from the four-way, and I love technical wrestling, absolutely love technical wrestling, always have. And he and I got to just, for like a couple of minutes, just go kind of hold for hold, not really, nothing discussed, nothing planned. And we come back from that match, he goes, yeah, you're a way better technical wrestler than I thought you would be. And I was like, thanks, man. I appreciate that. And yeah, again, just one of these other wee markers of, maybe I kind of do know what I'm talking about.
Your life seems to be a life of backhand compliments and quite good wrestling.
Yeah.
That seems to be the life. So, I mean, that same year, we got to see a bit more of Lewis Girvan as a character, because that December, you had the match with Drew Galloway at Spaceballs, which spawned, and I watched it again this morning, just because I knew it was in the back of my mind, was the search for Jinder. So, a young man by definitely not the name of Grant McIver, played the role of Heath Slater. And of course, because long hair, beard, you had the comparison to a young an elder Drew Galloway, because he didn't have a beard when he was younger. What was it like? I watched it back and I was like, I mean, you were fully clothed and all that kind of stuff. Grant had to go about in a vest all day. So how was that for pushing yourself out as trying to make yourself larger than life, recording that and then the match itself with Drew?
So to kind of peel the curtain back a little bit, like, that was a lot of fun because, again, it was the first time, certainly with an ICW, where I was being trusted with, trusted with a mic and trusted with, real promo time to, tell a bit of a narrative. Drew was obviously embroiled in all the ICW heavyweight championship match that he had with Jester and then his initial defences. And so it was very much like, people might remember ICW had, effectively like a trainee show called Spaceballs that they were going to do a series of. And that was kind of like my playground to tell this little story of, I want to challenge him for a match. I think the not so subtle implication being that he's of course not going to pay attention to a single word of this. It's very much just me blowing hot air. Mm-hmm. But I loved it because it was a chance to be silly and goofy and over the top in a way that I don't think I often got to. And then you summed up the promo I did with not Grant McIver as Heath Slater. That was actually the brainchild of Jackie Polo. He took very much a producer's role for Spaceballs, just with how big ICW was at the time. Other people really had to kind of chip in and help with the running of the various ventures. And him knowing that this match with Drew was going to be a big get for Spaceballs, Drew still being so recently back, he wanted to make sure that all the kind of promo work and the lead up to it was up to snuff, basically. And so, yeah, no, the initial plan, I'm not sure what we were going to do initially, because originally we had Saqib Ali, who was going to be playing Jinder, and it was going to be the three of us doing something.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very much on the day Saqib couldn't make it. And so we had to change it to, we were trying to find our Jinder. And so, yeah, no, that was very much, it was Jackie. And you say about me coming out of my shell, that's because Jackie was very good at going, no, I don't think that was big enough, do it again. And so there's some shots in that we had to do 5, 6, 7, 8 takes of. And God bless Grant, God bless him, wandering around Glasgow in December in nothing but a vest.
I thought, God, you said Saqib Ali, because I wrote down my notes, because I remembered it, and I thought, right, I'll write it down. And I thought I'd Mandela affected Saqib as Jinder, because I wrote it down,
mm-hmm.
Jinder, Saqib Ali. And I watched the video and I thought, well, have I just been really racist here and just assumed that Saqib was Jinder in this?
The big payoff is, so I have the match with Drew. He obviously beats me. And then I reveal that I do, in fact, have my own three-man band with me as Drew, Grant as Heath, Saqib as Jinder, and Chris Toe as Hornswoggle.
Right. Thank God it did happen. I didn't just imagine it and just went, oh, clearly Saqib must be Jinder. Phew. Oh, well, I feel a little bit. My heart's actually going a bit. Oh, my God. Have I just done a racism? Right. haven't. Good. Lost my train of thought a little bit, but we'll move back on to Discovery, because that's where we got to see, like, Lewis Girvan as essentially a main event guy who was kind of floating around the top into the main event, because you became the interim Y Division champion when Sabin was injured. You became the interim champion. Eventually, you became the fully fledged Y Division champion. I think it was officially announced, like, on a Q&A meet and greet with Honky Tonk Man or something like that.
So it was the Discovery End of Year Awards featuring a Q&A with the Honky Tonk Man, which was a whole wild evening unto itself. Because this was very much none of us had any idea what the Honky Tonk Man was going to be talking about. And he went off on some random stories. Meanwhile, we're trying to go through a polite award ceremony for all the Discovery wrestlers as well. But yeah, by that point, it had been about a year of being the interim champion. And the injury that Sabin got that meant that he couldn't make later Discovery shows ended up being a bit more serious than initially realised. He also lives in an area in America that's not super easy or cheap to get to or from. And so through a combination of factors, Alan made the decision. He's like, if and when we can get him back, we absolutely will. But at least for now, to kind of just drop the interim part, because it doesn't look like he'll be back anytime soon.
And from there, you became quite, again, a figurehead. That's when the Kings of Catch really started catching on. Even though you guys were a team down in Discovery, you were feuding up in the Northeast in WrestleZone, because that's how I was getting to watch his wrestle. So when did... We'll go back to the Y Division stuff briefly, because there'll be other things we'll bring up, because it's kind of intrinsically linked to the Kings of Catch stuff as well. What are your memories of Demo finally pushing you two together as a team, and how did it actually become the team?
So it all started when Source had become such a known entity for producing good wrestlers that people were coming from all over Europe, really. And I was really like, you know, I was in college at the time and I had a part-time job, but like I was in Source virtually every day at that point. Whenever any of these outside people would come in to train with Demo, he would very often have me there as, for lack of a better term, a bit of a test dummy. You know, I was falling over for all these people to try the things Demo was showing them. And Chris McCrabe, Scotty Swift and Aspen all came from WrestleZone one day, and they were basically just wanting really advice from Demo on their matches as a whole. So Demo had me work with them, and I certainly felt it in the match with him, and Demo pointed it after and went, there's a wee something to you and Aspen there. Like, there was a real chemistry to the way he's were working. Like, there was just it's just one of those intangibles. You couldn't quite put your finger on it, but it felt just that little bit different. Felt like, oh, there was something quite good there, which for, you know, a 5-6 minute training match, if you can see it there, there's definitely the bones of something more. And so Demo initially thought that rather than having us work against one another, having us be a team would be a good way for me to maybe branch out up into the WrestleZone area up north, and for Aspen to maybe come down into like the SWA, that kind of central belt. It's kind of be like a mutually beneficial thing built off the fact that we did have, you know, a decent bit of chemistry between us. So that was like the initial thought. But based off... To be honest, geographically, it was quite difficult because we could never train together outside of like rare times. And so it took us a wee while to kind of get moving with it. But once Discovery started up and once, you know, we were in each other's company a lot more, all the pieces started to come together so that by like the spring of 2016, we kind of had that first initial team up.
It was one of the highlights of... I'm getting a little bit of feedback. Are you still here?
I'm still here.
You're still here. That's fine. You were just really still for a second. I don't know if you were just listening intently. But it was one of those things where, I mean, I could see it. I was a big number one Aspen fan. Suck on that, Kyle. So I was a big fan of Aspen anyway. And get to see you guys wrestle like every couple of months, and you brought in Emerson Jane and now known as Debbie Dahmer. They brought into that, and we got the match at the Beach Ballroom, which you teamed with Viper instead. It wasn't a table match. It was next year.
That was the next one I had at Beach Ballroom. Yeah.
So you were branching out into more of a, I feel like SWA was quite more of a wrestling company, as in you put on good matches, people enjoyed that. But when you come up to WrestleZone, it's more of a story beat match. They don't necessarily need to see the technical wrestling, as long as they always do something quite entertaining or they can get a baldy chat going. They really don't really care about the matches itself. Did you find that kind of difference of wrestling Aspen in Discovery, where it's more wrestling based, to then a couple weeks later you'll be up in WrestleZone wrestling? Did that kind of keep it fresh, and you're able to bounce off more ideas, try things that you could bring to either or, whether you were doing that?
No, absolutely. Like, we had a submission match against one another in Discovery that was very much sold to us as we want this to be like intense and physical and like as much like a fight as possible. Whereas, like you say, our matches in WrestleZone were all very much based around the fact that him and Emerson Jane were meant to be this like dastardly duo that I just couldn't quite seem to get the better of. And I really liked that kind of juxtaposition of the two. It's one of the things I've been so grateful for, is getting to kind of travel around, as you do see what different areas and different audiences really react well to. And I think that's really what helped make me more well-rounded. I loved going up to WrestleZone, where they wanted a little bit more, I'm trying to think, more like over-the-top action, whereas in Discovery you could perhaps be a little bit more subdued just by the difference in the taste in the audience. Mm-hmm. And I like that challenge, you know, for Aspen and I to then go in and go, how do we do both while at the same time being true to what our individual acts are? Because it can be so easy to go to a different place and go, okay, I'm just going to be a totally different wrestler than I ever am. Whereas to still be the wrestler you are, but with like these little, like I said earlier, the shades of grey of how do I take the Lewis Girvan act and make it more Discovery, more WrestleZone, more ICW, more SWA?
Yeah. I mean, generally, you are going to be in a crowd where 80% of the people have maybe never seen wrestling before or only know you as wrestling on that event. Or there's going to be like one or two people in the crowd that spend a lot of their time writing for their own website that pays them nothing, but I just like doing it anyway. I mean, they like doing it anyway. And they keep track of all these kind of things. And you want to try and just keep it nice and balanced, I suppose, to try and appeal to everyone at the end of the day. I was just glancing over when I was doing that. I forgot that you won a triple threat match at Discovery Wrestling, which involved the current AEW World Heavyweight Champion, Swerve Strickland. This was a time where Discovery were just bringing in some just incredible names. I mean, they still do. That's
absolutely
not now, but they were bringing in huge names, UK and abroad, your Lucha guys, your Lucha Underground, folk like Angelico and the likes of that. But getting in with Swerve Strickland, how's that as an education for you?
So Swerve at that point, the biggest thing he had done was Lucha Underground, which was not something I, at least at that point in time, had been like massively exposed to. I think I'd seen some of the highlights, same as everyone else. And so it was quite funny where going in, I knew very, very little about him. I was very much just on the day. And I distinctly remember it was like during the match, I was like, oh, he's quite good. he actually really knows what he's doing. Supremely talented then. But I think the last couple years, 3-4 years really, is he's really, a bit like what I'm saying, is like he had the physical tools for such a long time. It was about finding the appearance tools. It was finding the performance, that kind of, how does he perform all this in such a way that an audience can attach themselves to it above and beyond the cool moves that he does. And I think he's done obviously fantastically well because of it.
And the BT Gun was the other one in that name. Make sure that I didn't forget that either, because just in case BT listens and he chops me, which I really don't want.
I've told this story before, but I will always come to it. People will have the thing that made them want to be a wrestler. For me, it was watching BT Gun win the SWA title. Like, that was the moment where I was like, oh, I definitely want to do this for the rest of my life, like that. And I've told him that, like, he was very much one of the guys I looked up to. He's someone I'm very grateful and I feel very fortunate to have worked with a lot. He's someone that I like to think I could call a friend. And yeah, no, it's just I'll always bring it up. It goes, if it wasn't for BT Gunn, I probably would be a wrestler.
I'm going, mentioned 2013, mentioned 2014, these huge names that would, or huge names then, and they've just gotten even bigger now. Every year, I'm just seeing names here that are just like unbelievable. I mean, just in that year alone, 2016, I didn't even mention Timothy Thatcher, who seems like an absolute ideal opponent for someone who likes technical wrestling over at Source.
Absolutely.
So you had Timothy Thatcher and Shane Strickland, you had Chris Ridgeway, again, another very much technical based wrestler who's gone on to do phenomenal things around England, and he's made some trips back up north. You mentioned imposter syndrome, so I think I probably know the answer to the question I eventually get to here. And wrestling in Chicago that year as well against Mustache Mountain, and who would go, and Tegan Knox, the eventual Tegan Knox. Is there a moment where you look back at, I don't know if you write down your matches or you rely on the Germans as well, that you look back on your year and just go, how have I managed to amass these many names, these many matches, with this level of opponents? Or are you just quite confident at the end of the year just going, yeah, I did that. Of course I did. I'm the best young wrestler.
I think depending on when you ask me would depend on my answer. Like, there was definitely at one point, see when like you're right in the thick of it and you're rocking and rolling, like there is a degree of, oh yeah, you know, like I would be in that match. But no, see, certainly now, in my old age, you know, I look back and I realize that like I worked extremely hard to be in these positions, but that was like 50% of the equation. You know, another part of it is it's like to really be on the come up in such like a wonderful boom period for British wrestling, where all this talent was here. To be able to have people who saw the talent that I had, the work that I put in, and for them to trust me, because that's ultimately what it is. When a promoter puts you in the ring with talent of a certain caliber, they are trusting you to meet that and to match that. Like even just other random ones over the years, like in 2012 when I did the All-Star summer camps, I wrestled a very young Cash Wheeler before he would go on to do everything that he's gone on to do. I had Tommy Enns' last ICW match before he would go on to do all manner of amazing things. It's just I'm immensely grateful. I take everything that they've taught me. I'm a big, big believer in paying it forward. And so any little tidbits I've gotten from them, I now try my best to give out to the people that I wrestle now. And that to me is something that was always impressed upon me, is it's like wrestling's, what's the right phrase? It's like a team effort. No one guy can do a good show on his own. You know, we all need to like give these back and forth, and it's that kind of community spirit that I think really helped kind of not just British wrestling, but Scottish wrestling in particular, really, really be like the lightning rod for the big boom that European wrestling enjoyed for a number of years.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, going ahead, we'll lump the next couple disco points here, which is going to be first up, the four-way with the Young Bucks. So this is when the Kings of Catch are properly getting going. More with the Young Bucks, and then of course the main event of the Elite Show, where you, BT Gunn and Joe Coffey, took on what is known as the Elite. So the Young Bucks and Kenny Omega, and these were incredible shows. I remember watching the Elite Show back on YouTube, and the size of the crowd is probably the biggest crowd I think Disco's possibly ever had.
On a Wednesday night, they had over 1,000 people. Yeah,
and it was incredible. I remember watching this. I remember loving this match at the time as well. And this was 2017, where you've again had a couple pretty high profile matches in the months before and after of that. Working with the Elite, then they're a hot topic in the world of professional wrestling. How was your experience with the Jacksons and Omega and the like?
So, I've heard stories of like, say, someone like Prince or David Bowie, where they've got this very weird creative process that to an outsider maybe doesn't make sense, but then somehow it all comes out and it's magic. It's amazing. That is probably the best comparison I can make to Kenny Omega. He's got such a very unique and like specific to him way of looking at wrestling that I think all at once made it, it made so much sense why he was as good as he was, but at the same time made it very, very daunting, the process of like getting in the ring with him. Because it's like, it's this is a guy who, oh, he's very much, you know, marching to the beat of his own drum. And kind of like I keep saying, it's like, when you're in the ring with Kenny, it's your job to meet him there. You know, he's very much not going to make sure that, like, he absolutely could, but he knows his job at that point is not to drag me up. He's trusting that he's been put in the ring with someone that can match him to a degree. And I couldn't have asked for better people to be teaming with than BT Gunn and Joe Coffey in that six-man tag. And then, like you say, the four-corner tag with the Bucks to have Aspen, you know, who, like I say, one of the most natural dynamics I've ever had in my life. The Young Bucks were fantastic as well, a bit more straightforward, but still very, very just, you want to talk about two guys that they know their act inside and out. They know every, like from the second they walk through the curtain to the second they walk back, be it the match, the entrance, anything they might say on the microphone, like they just, they knew who they were. And that to me was a real sign of, oh, you want to talk about one of those early times where I was like, oh, I see that there is so much more to wrestling than just wrestling. And that was a real like, okay, I'm starting to get it. I'm really starting to put the pieces together that from one bell to the next, that bit's pretty important, but it's the whole package, you know? Mm-hmm. And I actually think they don't get enough credit for that. Like they know precisely who the Young Bucks are and Kenny knows exactly who Kenny Omega is.
I mean, that show, watch it back, and it was just an incredible spectacle to see that 1,000 people on a Wednesday night as well. Sandwiched in between those two matches with the Jacksons, and sounds like a cover band that we're going to see sing Can You Feel It, but sandwiched in between that was the Hydro against Ricochet in the match of the night at the Hydro for Fear and Loathing 9. And that's not me saying that. That was pretty much anyone I spoke to that night. Fear and Loathing 9 was you and Ricochet, or as he introduced himself to me as Trevor. That was an incredible night, especially in the Hydro. So I think, was this the first Hydro show?
It was.
So what was that, 4,000-5,000 people?
6,193.
There we go.
Not that I've got it memorized or anything.
No, you're going to get a tattoo like Osprey. So that match against Ricochet, like I say, a lot of people loved it. I think I watched it live streamed. I watched it in comfort of my own home, and remember it was amazing at the time. Did you know it was special when you had that match with Ricochet? Or yeah, what was your thoughts on that one?
So that day is such an absolute blur to me, because as fortunate as I have been in my time in wrestling, there has also been like so many cool things that were supposed to happen that never quite worked out. And wrestling Ricochet is one of those things that he was supposed to do SWA in 2013 against me, and then the show never happened. And then I was initially wrestling him when he did Discovery in 2016, the start of, and then that didn't happen. So we'd kind of crossed paths almost sort of kind of a few times. And so to finally have it happening and have it happen on the stage that it was, like I remember, I always get a degree in nerves, even now, before matches. I'm a big, big believer that the nerves are a wee sign that you still care, that you still want it to go well. But that's like one of the most nervous and worked up and just at 11 I've been for an entire day. Because it wasn't even just a case of being on this massive show. I'm sure everyone felt those nerves. But to be in a match with someone that, like, there was a lot of expectation on it. You know, he was very much on a tear at that point. Within less than 18 months of that show, he would be in WWE. And so, yeah, it was very much in the ring. There was a moment where we do a sequence of thing, 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 and then we're both down and the crowd come up in, like, appreciation of that little display we'd just done. And I do distinctly remember going, like, I'm looking up at, like, the ceiling that feels like it's miles away, because it's far and away the biggest venue I've ever been in. And just to say, I remember going, okay, I think this is going well.
I mean, no additional pressure in that match as well, but you're in the same venue as Team 3D, as Angle as well. you know, if there's ever a moment for that imposter, again, I've said earlier, but any point for that imposter syndrome to hit, that is definitely going to be it. But yeah, sorry, Andrew. Yeah, carry on.
No, not at all. I'm kind of glad you mentioned the imposter syndrome, because as cool as that night was, it led to something that would become like a real driving force for me. So I went, a bunch of people went out after that into Glasgow City Centre. I was in the Cat House, and it was really, really nice. Like, I had never experienced anything like this. Fans and workers alike telling me how good the match was and how much they enjoyed it. And as someone that's always felt like a little bit of an outsider, like I keep saying, like a little bit of an imposter, to have it, it was the first time, and I remember thinking this, I felt like I was part of the team for like the first time. And that was really important to me, to kind of properly found that camaraderie. Because while I had that at source in SWA, the folk I trained with, ICW certainly always felt like this other world. In no small part because I was like younger than everyone else by like 5 to 10 years, and that wasn't lost on me either. And I just remember that night going, I feel like part of the team. And within 6 months, I was getting left off shows again. And that became such a point of contention for me that really lit a fire under me going, I am going to prove to you that I am so much more than just the plain Jane wrestler that you seem to think I am. And that, coupled with Aspen coming in, I think is really why we would then go on to have as good a run we did as a team. Because I had found this newfound source of motivation to really go, I'm going to show you this whole other side to me.
And on our side, we definitely got, because a little bit ahead of ourselves there, but you had the Kings of Catch, then the Filthy Generation, which we talked about those Shades of Grey thing. There was a good split of people who loved the Filthy Generation, with you, Aspen, Stevie Boy, and the future Alba Fire, Kaylee Ray at the time. And there was a good portion of people that absolutely hated you with an absolute passion. No surprise which camp I'm in that situation, but we'll leave that be. But Filthy Generation was the first time, you guys, I feel that you got a real focal point in ICW because of that group, because Stevie Boy was undeniable at that point. Kaylee Ray, I mean, an absolute legend of Scottish wrestling. She's still doing amazing work in WWE, and the chemistry of the Kings of Catch as well, just all kind of work together. When you talk about people coming up to you and all that kind of stuff, was the Filthy Generation stuff when you were properly starting to get kind of a bit more social interaction with fans, and people were a bit more, maybe not less afraid to let you know about you, whether they liked you or not?
So I think I'm a big believer that you could be the absolute best wrestler in the world, but if people are only seeing you once every 6 months, 9 months, once a year, if you don't have equity with the audience, you can't build an emotional connection with them. And I do think that was something I really struggled with those first few years in ICW. I would be on a run of a few shows here or there, and then I would be seen for a month, 2 months, 5, 6 months, whatever it might be. And I think that's something I struggled with. And so when Aspen and I started teaming, and then we joined the Filthy Generation, just having that presence on shows, it allowed us to build that emotional relationship with the audience, where they began to, in no small part through the videos that Aspen and I were doing, like I was saying, but even just having that constant presence on shows, it meant folks started to go, oh, I get it now. And that's like, they got why we interacted the way they did. They got what our motivations were. Even just having a match on every show, it lets them go, oh, I'm starting to recognize what moves are theirs and why they're important. You know, it's like, to have that time put in with the audience, I think, went a long, long way. And like you say, some folk really grew to love our act, some folk really grew to hate our act, but we were developing a relationship with the audience where they cared what we were doing one way or another. And that was the most important thing.
I mean, especially the Kings of Catch stuff. I remember when you guys became a team in WrestleZone. I still remember the reaction. You had a match. I think Aspen had a match earlier in the night, and you had a triple threat, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And the first match, your match, you had the trunks on and all that kind of stuff. And then when you came back out later on, you were like in shorts and you had a hoodie on. And I was sitting there literally three rows back going, oh my God, oh my God. Because you've built up that equity as a team, that when you finally revealed, you took off the hoodie and there was the Filthy Generation or Kings of Catch, whatever merch it was. Mm-hmm. It was the Northern Hotel was like everyone knew you guys were a team. It was just, we were all waiting for you to finally be a team up here. So again, that's building your equity and what have you. So I don't know how much more we can talk about Kings of Catch, because I could probably again spend another hour doing that as well. But you had the Kings of Insanity as well, the Hydro. I don't know how much being loving technical wrestling and growing into this more story-based wrestling. How was hardcore wrestling for you doing things like the Kings of Insanity?
So, 2 seconds. Are we going to put the light on? Because I'm
fine.
In total darkness.
You're fading away like Kate Bush in a music video. There we go.
Sorry about that.
Still just as blurry, but it's fine.
So, the transition into more hardcore deathmatch-esque style wrestling, to be honest, I loved it. I really, really did. I really felt like, if I look at my career in phases, I felt like I had really proven my point as a straight-laced, like, pure wrestler. I feel like all the names you mentioned, like the matches with Ricochet, with Strickland, with BT Gunn, with the Elite, and the 100 other names, I really felt like, okay, I've produced a body of work that if folk want to know if I'm a good wrestler in the traditional sense, they now know that. And so making that transition into like the more character promo-based stuff that Aspen and I were doing, and then the next edition of that then being, we can do more gimmick matches, like we did ladder matches, we did cage matches, we did Kings of Insanity. To me, it was all about, I'm now showcasing a different facet of what I can do. And it was great because it was a total breath of fresh air at a time where, like, Aspen and I both really, really enjoyed it, you know? He's obviously gone on to do way more deathmatch stuff than I have. But to have the capacity to do it, to totally push myself outside my comfort zone, to push myself as a performer, I loved it. Still bearing some marks from it, but it was good at the time.
Was that the... was it yourself that got the thing stuck in your head?
The skewers, yes.
The skewers,
yes,
that's
me.
The one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that as fun as it looks?
So, it obviously hurt, but not in the way that I was anticipating, and I don't know if that made it better or worse. So, I was so worried about the feeling of being stabbed that I forgot that Stevie James is on the other side having to stab me. And so when you do skewers, the traditional technique is you would hold them against the head and then kind of like bang the top so that they stick in. Stevie didn't know this, and God bless him, he just reared back and as hard as he could spiked them on top of my head. So that initial jolt to the neck was actually the most painful part.
Oh, I think I'm just doing a little bit just the thought of it. Can't even remember if you had to deal with Crowbar's carpet gripper obsession either.
Oh no, that was his idea and we left him to it. God bless him, he made a table out of carpet grippers, forgetting that the carpet grippers had effectively reinforced the table. So he lands on it and is just stuck to it because it didn't break, it didn't smash. So effectively crucified.
Is that one of those moments where you watch it happen and going, yeah, that seems about right. That's probably as well as it was going to go.
Well, I was honestly, more than anything, I know it sounds so daft given the kind of match we were in, but more than anything, I was like, I just hope it doesn't hurt him that badly. And then when I saw him land and I heard what could only be described as like all the oxygen in his body leaving him, I went, well, I bet it hurt.
Just waiting the death rattle just to go with it. Oh, God, that is horrendous to think about. So we're going to bounce forward because I'm seeing the time, and I'm not even joking to anyone listening, I could literally have you on here for about 3 hours and I could probably still find things to speak about. So we're going to bounce a little bit more, we're still in 2018 for time scale here. So you're doing stuff with the Kings of Catch, you're winning tag team titles, WrestleZone tag team titles, and the ICW tag team titles, of which I do have a picture of us all with the belts. It had to be an extra fiver to get a picture with the ICW belts. Just the same. But you were enjoying yourself as a tag team wrestler. Were you finding that was more your kind of path? Now you've done your body of work as a technical wrestler. You've done a little bit as the hardcore wrestler. Was tag team wrestling always something that you always came back to and you felt comfortable with?
I think yes to the feeling comfortable with it. I think I was extremely fortunate that I'd found a tag partner that I had so much in common with. But like, this will sound bad, but like the right amount not in common with. I felt like it kept things fresh. We were never like bored of the team, especially not when it was like, so I always give the advice to young wrestlers. It's like, there is never enough tag teams ever. And if you can get a good tag act going, it can really help you broaden your horizons. And so Aspen and I did a lot in Discovery, WrestleZone, ICW. Once we became the ICW tag team champions, we were able to then go over to Ireland on a number of occasions. And I could go on all day about how much my trips to Ireland have really meant to my career as well. But getting to like do that with Aspen, to get to defend the belts, that little bit out with the traditional bubble of ICW, and the people that we got to wrestle as a result. I think I really loved teaming with Aspen. It was comfortable. But rather than it being like a mellow normal, I think it also motivated us both to keep wanting to be better. You know, one thing I really need to give Aspen credit for is there always was like a friendly kind of rivalry between the two. You know, mm-hmm. We would do things like, you been at the gym today? Because I have, you know, things like that.
A bit, and also intense purposes, because of what you can do and your looks, you guys, as singles wrestlers, would be going after the same spots, really, on a card. So the fact that you're able to still be able to work shows because you're a highly respected tag team act, it made it all the better. 2020 rolled round, a big hiatus from life because of a big scary pandemic, and then that was your shows for about 2 years. You came back, got here Respect Pro when you came back. Mm-hmm. 2 years off wrestling, 2 years off bumping your body like mad. First match back, Foundation of the Future. That doesn't seem like a wise move, really, when you're taking 2 years off. But during that two-year period, I'm no doubt there would be a moment where, much like every other wrestler, had during that year and a half, 2 years, where he thought, am I coming back? What was the thought process between you coming back and then that match happening itself? What was your position in wrestling in your mind?
I just wanted to get back to it, really. Like, wrestling has, for as long as I can remember, been the most pivotal, central, vital part of my life. And so any match and any opponent and any promotion, like, I just wanted to get back to it. And I really can't say enough good things that is about the Foundation of the Future for being three of the perfect guys to really help me, you know, because you want to talk about imposter syndrome, to come back after all that time off and to go, I don't know, like, you know, outside of wrestling, I'm not a performer. You know, I've not been in front of a crowd. I've not been in front of people. I don't know if I can do this anymore. And God bless all three of them. They were patient. They were helpful. They were encouraging. And they took such good care of me. I mentioned earlier that I take a lot of pride in trying to like, take care of my opponents. Every time I see Zack Dynamite, to this day, you know, a couple of years later, I will still apologize to him, because in that match, I was the most ham-fisted, clumsy wrestler that has ever existed. I was so like, couldn't feel my arms and legs, that level of like nervous, and still just so gracious with me.
I've said to Zack myself, like, I think he's probably one of the best wrestlers in the country. However, when the bell rings, I will hate him for the next 25 minutes, vehemently. And then once the show ends, I've often seen him like after the show in like Tesco for some reason. It's always really weird. So like, I just booed you for the last 20 minutes. But yeah, just that 20 minutes, it's so good, because that 20 minutes, I hate him with an absolute passion. He makes me believe. And at 34, I'm still going to wrestling shows and believing that these people in front of me are absolute bastards. And that's a testament to guys like the Foundation that can do that. But yeah, so that was you back after a long layoff and a couple of matches here and there. But the one that I think we should really focus on, because it's now where your future is, well, where your present is, maybe not your future, where your present is the last Source show. You got in the ring with a mystery opponent, which ended up being Fraser Girvan, your brother, for the final Source show, a place where you'd started your career when it was SWA, when it moved into Source, to finish the last show with your brother. That, how emotional was that day?
So I said earlier about how Demo taking over coincided very, very closely to me starting. So this is not like an official thing. Like, this is very much just my headcanon, but I can almost see myself as like the first Source trainee. And so there was something just so nice and so like full circle of my brother being the last graduate of Source Wrestling. Mm-hmm. And so it was a super emotional day for a whole bunch of reasons, you know. David Devlin, who ran Source for the last couple of years, God bless him, he did everything he could, but just with like all the changes and like the cost of living, running a wrestling school is such a monumental task, and he really did everything in his power to keep it going. And so that kind of, that swan song, that last show, for like I say, the school that has got to be up there in terms of like the amount of world-class talent that's produced, to get to usher my brother into the wrestling world on it, to get to have so many family there as well. It was just like, I couldn't have asked for like altogether a nicer experience to see off that place. And I don't even just specifically mean for Fraser and I. It was like things like Glenn Dunbar being the last Source champion, the most deserving guy in the world for it. It felt very appropriate. It felt very nice. And it felt like, yeah, like this is not, what's the expression? Glad that it happened in equal parts to being sad that it's over.
Yeah. That seems to be the general consensus when I'm speaking to Source guys. Moving on, but not forgetting where you're from at the same time. And that was you. You went to GPWA, who took over the school, and that was tag team. The Girvans were born. And I know there were some names bandied about, and I don't know if you've ever settled on anything more than the Girvans, but it's been a while since I spoke to Fraser. So if did you have any suggestions for a tandem name, or are you just happy with the Girvans?
So I am trying to make it the Brothers Girvan, just to make it marginally different, and it rolls off, in my mind at least, like the Brothers Grimm. Mm-hmm. I think so many folk just take for granted that, oh, the Girvan brothers are the Girvans, which is fine. You know, I'm obviously not going to begrudge folk calling us by our name. I'm like, if you could just please call us the Brothers Girvan. regardless of the team name, it's so... Like, I love teaming with Fraser. He amazes and frustrates me in equal measure.
It's quite a roller coaster when you're teaming with him, I'm sure. I'll never forget that story.
he'll remind you of it if you do.
Because after a couple of years, of course, pandemic and all that kind of stuff, it felt like, from an outsider's perspective, that you got teamed with Fraser, it's kind of like a safe space kind of thing, because you're getting to do shows with your brother who you've brought into wrestling. You brought into the madhouse of professional wrestling, even though he seemed to kick and scream his way in and out of trying to get in, and then like the hokey pokey, he was in and out, and then eventually shook it all about and got in. Is that how you find the relationship that you have with wrestling with Fraser? Is that it's not comfortable. Comfortable's not the right word, but you know what I mean? It was like, you know he's there. You know you've got someone that you can trust that's there by you the whole time, and even though he's going to annoy the absolute living piss out of you, you know that he's got your back and you've got his. Is that how dynamic works?
I do think that's a big part of it, honestly. You know, like, Fraser and I feel very... I say this a lot today. I feel very lucky that Fraser and I have always got on so well. Like, I know a lot of siblings go through periods, maybe when they're younger, where they tend to bicker or fight a lot, not get on. But genuinely, Fraser and I have always been best friends. And to see him finally, like you say, like some things out with his control kind of really stopped him from wrestling as young as he might have liked. But just to finally see him get that consistent track, finally have that first match and now get to work together, it's so great because it means I get to be right there to kind of watch him find his sea legs, as it were, to see these little realizations, these little learning moments in the ring as they're happening, and to as much as possible kind of try and pass on the knowledge that others were kind enough to give to me. And like I say, like the amazing part is like whenever Fraser will like do or say something where I go, huh, that's perfect. You know, that makes total sense. You know, yeah, that's right. And then when the frustration is when he'll make another suggestion very confident, I'm like, ow, so close. But you know, like genuinely, like I think he has come along so exceptionally well in such a short amount of time. And for all the help that I've tried to give him and others, I do think the biggest credit goes to him, because giving the help is half the job. In fact, I would wager it's only about 25% of the job. What you do, the information given to you, is like the biggest factor. And he's done exceptionally well.
So before we get, because this episode will come out before Bard, so that's quite a big match to speak about against Arcade Violence inside a steel cage. There is one more thing that I wanted to bring up, and it's the comedy show, the Great Glasgow Bash. So someone who looked like you, called Drew Galladay, faced BBC Scotland's very own, the Scots' very own Stoner McGregor. Now, for someone who's flirted with the comedic side of things through things like The Kings of Catch, and again, you're still kind of the straight man to Fraser Girvan now when it comes to a promo style. What was it like? What was it like being Drew Galladay for 20 minutes?
Like the most natural thing in the world. It was the part I was born to play. I loved it. I genuinely did. I loved it most in that it was just not my idea. This was very much, I came in to the office one day and the powers that be were all like, do you want to be Drew for a day? And I was just like, huh? what I really loved about Glasgow Bash, not just even my match, was that it was just so much fun seeing people kind of get to relax a little bit, you know? All of us, all wrestlers, it's like we want to take ourselves seriously to the extent that like the audience can take us seriously. But getting a show where everyone got to kind of just cut loose and almost like have fun, I think brought out such a great creative side of everybody. Like to pull back the curtain a tiny bit, Debbie Dammer is a good friend of mine, and she was on that show as Acid Bath Princess of the Night. And so getting to help her film like the kind of head of the show promo, and just seeing like just having a laugh and having fun and just getting to be creative, ideas that you might come up with that you could never normally use. Was really cool, and getting to like, you know, do all Drew's moves, that was cool. Getting to work with Stoner McGregor and his extensive wrestling background.
It's the fact that you absolutely know, because it's Jester, I mean sorry, it's Stoner McGregor there, that there is a 90% chance that Drew will have watched you be Drew, even though you've wrestled him before. Cameron, did you get a sword? Are you able to?
Yeah, I got an inflatable sword. Yeah.
Oh well, close enough. That'll do. So yeah, I just wanted to bring up, because it was just when the match was announced, it felt like the most natural thing, because you've had that comparison for years of the Drew Galloway thing, again because of the beard and the hair and the and the like, but to finally be Drew for the day, did you put on the accent? What's the phrase? Were you immersive in the role for the whole day?
Yeah, so I stayed up all the night before, because if anyone that has ever spoken to Drew will tell you anything, it's that the man is constantly tired. Like, you will say, good morning, Drew, how are you? I'm quite tired. Oh, afternoon, Drew, what's going on? I'm a bit sleepy. Okay, Drew, we get it. it was. And I think it was funny for me because like I've always gotten the Drew comparison from like since my first day. I've always gotten it, even like, you know, unsung heroes of Scottish wrestling, David and Elaine Wilson, who knew Drew when he was like a teenager. They would always say it's not even just like the way you look, it's like you sound like he did at that age, and you've got a similar personality to him. Like, you know, he's come across quite similar. And I always thought, okay, I can kind of get it. But then I am now the age that Drew was when he came back to ICW. And so I see some of his matches from that time and I go, oh, okay, no, I really see it now.
So Bard 3, and we've got some questions through the Instagram. Bard 3, Arcade Violence, Steel Cage match. From the heavy roasting, we know that there's some sort of tag team implication. I'm just going to assume it's going to be in the number one contenders, some description. But steel cage match, all steel cage matches on this show, that's a little bit of pressure for it to stand out. And I've loved what I've seen from Arcade Violence so far. I know what you've been about. I've watched you for about 10 years now, not to make you feel old. But and every time I've seen Fraser wrestle, it's just I think I called him a bulldog once because this is going to be, I don't know if you're going to accept this comparison, but you're very much a Hart Foundation dynamic where with you being the Brett and him being Neidhart kind of thing. Where he's just,
you know, I've genuinely never thought that, but actually, as soon as you say it, I totally get what you mean. Yes, no, I will 1000% take that comparison. Thank you.
So you're coming against Arcade Violence, who again is a team I really enjoy watching. You've wrestled a few times through things like Blockbuster and what have you. How do you kind of make sure your match stands out when it's all cage matches?
What I think we have going for us is all four of us have the exact same mentality of we are all in equal parts, think it's really cool where we are, but we're not content with where we are. All of us want to really do everything we can to make as much of a statement as possible, to really start to climb the ranks, you know, like it's nothing official in terms of number one contenders, but it's like to really go on a show of that level that's going to attract that, you know, size of audience, and to have folk go, you know, that was physical and that was intense, and you know, you saw that they really poured everything they could into that. Fraser is still young enough that he's willing to jump off tall things, so we have that going for us as well. Unfortunately, my knees are made of Cadbury's at this point, so I don't think I'm jumping off anything high too tall.
Oh, I mean, speaking of that, I remember was it a triple threat cage match at the Beach Leisure Centre where I watched it was yourselves, Blue Thunder, William Sterling, and Johnny Lyon, Scotty Swift. And you, I think you got away quite lightly. I remember Aspen's moonsault, which, speaking of knees like Cadbury's, I'm surprised his didn't explode the moment he landed because nobody caught him. Yeah. Everyone parted like the Red Sea.
Yeah, I will put my hand up and I will say I should have done a better job catching him. But if there was anyone in that pile that shouldn't have been catching him, it was me.
So you've learned from your experiences, I'm sure, for cage matches. But no, it's going to be on a Thriller for those that are unaware. September 1st, it's going to take place at the Garage, which is a little bit bigger than the Asylum, a little bit more atmospheric as well, because the Asylum, it's a bit intimate at times, but the Garage is it's very much the mecca of Insane Championship Wrestling. So very excited to find out more about that when the time arrives, which when this episode goes out will only be like 2-3 weeks away. So we'll see how that ramps up in the next few weeks. So on to Instagram, and then we'll do a nice wee wrap up of your hopes and dreams, and then we'll scoot away because I think we may hit the 2-hour mark, which I'm not surprised about at all when I knew I was getting you on the show. We have questions through Instagram. They've asked to be anonymous. I can tell you it is afterwards if you so wish. With three questions, he's asked, favourite Hydro show, first of all.
That's tough because certainly from my own experience of each of them, they were all so unique. I had three very, very different matches on all the Hydro shows. I think, honestly, I would have to say, just because of the sheer magnitude of it and just how across the board well it went, it would have to be the first one, you know? My juxtaposition from the first to the second one was quite extreme. The first one, I'm obviously in that singles match with Ricochet. The second year, it was myself and Aspen against Jack Jester and Chas Samuels. And so the second year for me, it was that's a good example of like that was being a pure wrestler versus more of a performance based match. You know, Jester and Shah had such, you know, an elaborate act that, you know, you want to talk about two guys who knew precisely how to perform, you know, Jack Jester and Shah Samuels. So that was like a challenge in a different way. And then the third year was a six-team TLC match, which was just chaos from start to finish. Mm-hmm. But no, I just think the first year at the Hydro, everyone turned up that day wearing their Sunday best, all in suits. The match that I got to have, you know, just all of it, it definitely has to be the first one.
Am I right? Was that the one with the Briscoes?
Or it was the six-team TLC, yes.
How have I not wrote down the the Briscoes, how is that as a team to interact with?
When it comes to tag team wrestling, they are two guys that could have been the most, everyone else sit down, shut up, and this is what you're doing. But could not have been more gracious, could not have been more accommodating, could not have been more like, hey, we know we're the outsiders coming in here. You guys are all the established acts. Please, you tell us, what do you need? How can we help you all get over? And that was something that, like, I think really is a testament to why they've had, unfortunately, the longevity that they did, was that it was very much a, we know ourselves, we're going to get ourselves over, how can we help you? All the best folk I've ever worked with have had attitudes like that. It's not about, you know, me, myself, and I, it's about how can we as a collective work here? And that's just what jumps to mind with the Briscoes. Because in a six-team TLC, it would be so easy for any two people to get lost in the shuffle, and they really helped to make sure that it wasn't that at all.
Again, adding to these lists of fantastical names that you've come across over your time. The next question I've got here is best match post COVID. I assume they mean one of your matches, best post COVID.
That's quite tough, actually. I think for me personally, because this is a match that wasn't just a good wrestling match onto its own, I felt like we touched on a lot of history, was my Zero-G title match with Stevie James at the Square Go. There's a few other matches, like I feel like Fraser and I against Victory Incorporated at a recent ICW show, I felt went really, really well. I had a Source Championship match against Stone Malone that I remember really, really enjoying. But now just getting to revisit that history with Stevie, coupled with the fact that it was a good match, I think that one's got to be my favourite since COVID.
The final question they put in is, what import did you learn the most from? And you have an absolute ton to choose from.
That is a very, very good question, actually. It's so funny. I'll think of one and I'll go, but with this person, but with that person. A name that some people probably haven't heard of, but I think he caught me at a very formative time in my wrestling career. A Canadian wrestler by the name of Brody Steele, who I did the camps with, the All-Star Summer Camps. I was 17. I was, you know, right in the thick of my X Division, Ring of Honor, PWG loving wrestling. And he was the first guy who was really able to, because we were wrestling every day for weeks in like 6 and 8 and 10 man tags. He was able to really hands-on go, no. This is how you get a lot more out of a lot less. This is how you really focus on, you know, the people, not, you know, wrestling's not about you and your opponent doing moves to one another. It's about these people reacting accordingly. And so he is one that I will say really, really helped me a lot in that regard in terms of like slow down, you know, which I'm sure every wrestler's heard 1,000 times. But other than that, this almost feels like a cheat answer because it sounds so obvious, but it is also true. It would be Kenny Omega. Like I said earlier, he has got such a unique way of looking at wrestling, that getting to just take tiny little bits of, because I was 1,000 questions from that day. I wanted to know why he was doing what he was doing, not just how or when or where. And so to really get to dissect that a little bit, I think gave me so many tools that I'll still reference to today. Even as I've like changed the way I wrestle, it's so universally applicable. That's where I think he is so good.
He seems like the kind of guy that floats, you know, he just kind of floats by things and just, I don't know, like I was going to call him a pixie. That seems really detrimental, but he does. He just seems like he'll just waft in and maybe just make a little suggestion and suddenly just float away, like that. What about Sugar Dunkerton as one part of the big bad body daddies?
I'm so, so glad you brought up Sugar Dunkerton, because like that was such an added, element to what Aspen and I were doing at the time. And you want to talk about a guy that just, wrestling should be fun, and he just, it is always so much fun with him. And it was so good getting to do like the initial filth life with him, the few matches that we got to do as a team, and even he and I as opponents. And just as he really floated around the Scottish scene over the course of like a good year and a half, 2 years, just what a guy. I think the best thing I learned from him was he gave me a line that still I will think about it every single time I wrestle, actually. So I'm really glad you mentioned him. He said, and I say this to young wrestlers, because there's that worry when you walk out at first and the crowd don't react. That can be daunting, and that can, like, to an extent be like, you know, quite demoralizing. Oh, the crowd don't really know who I am. He said, it's okay if you don't have them on the way out. Work to make sure you have them on the way back. As you're leaving, they go, that guy was okay, wasn't he? You know, like, and that to me, always, every single match I ever have, I'll think about that at least once.
A guy that I got the wee group shot for. I might end up putting them in the end, like a nice wee credits at the end of the episode. But I got the group shot with you guys. That was Assembly in Aberdeen.
Mm-hmm.
Got the big bad body daddy triple shot. Worsome comes there as well. Very awkward time. I wore a cardigan. Don't know why. The other question that we've got coming in to Instagram is from Andrew. He has asked, how long was your longest wrestling bout?
Longest specific match I ever had was myself versus Solar. It was a gay pride festival in which it was part of a gala day. So we were going to be wrestling, not him and I specifically, but like a series of matches over the course of several hours. But the ring, where the space we'd been given, was behind the main stage. And so no one knew we were there. And so Damo sent Solar and I out as a pair of teenagers, you know, with all the energy in the world. He goes, just wrestle until a crowd appears. So we wrestled. And we wrestled. And we wrestled. And just no one appeared. I think we had maybe six people where after 49 minutes of wrestling, we just went, enough's enough. I'm absolutely dying. And so we finished however it was we finished, and we went back to Damo, just absolutely like dying laughing. Like, he goes, God bless you. She's absolutely tried your best. But yeah, dude, just that crowd was not interested in what we were putting down on that particular day.
So I could pick and choose more amazing guests. Is there anyone that maybe I haven't mentioned yet that you want to make sure they do get a little checkpoint in your wrestling history that I haven't been able to find? I mean, Jody Fleisch is in that list somewhere as well.
Oh, yeah. Jody Fleisch is one of two guys alongside Tom Latimer, who's now in the NWA, where like, I went into a match with them thinking, oh, I think I'm quite good. And then I walked out of the match going, oh, wait, no. They're good, and I'm still playing catch-up here. Like, Jody Fleisch, I feel retroactively quite bad. At the time I had a singles match with him, I, unbeknownst to me at the time, had a mild concussion. And so I just thought, oh, my God, he's, like, so much faster than I am. And, like, he's so crisp, and I'm not. Meanwhile, my brain was mush at the time. But I'm very glad to say that I got to work with him a bunch more times. And, yeah, just, like, you want to talk about a legend in his own time, Jody Fleisch, just there is probably not a match, at least certainly in the UK in the last 15, 20 years, that doesn't have his fingerprints on it somewhere. He's worked someday, or he's done a move in front of somebody, or he's done something that someone's went, that's cool. And ipso facto, it's just ended up everywhere.
I mean, him and Johnny Storm was the match, mm-hmm. was the touring match. And, finally got to see Johnny Storm wrestle live, I think it was last year, and even now, 2023, I saw him and I was like, oh my God, Johnny mm-hmm. Storm, you know?
Tell me about it.
Here he's the main attraction. I remember the Wrestling Channel ads and all that kind of stuff, and here he was, the Elgin, of all places. Mm-hmm. Another guy, just before we, I will try and wrap up, a guy that seems to pop into your life, certainly for your formative years, you seem to check in with almost yearly, was Joe Hendry, who is, of course, taking over the wrestling world now, because everyone believes in Joe Hendry. And that was very, because I know it's like 10 o'clock, I don't want to clap too loud.
We timid clap.
Just in case he appears. Checking in with him each year and now seeing where he is, how's that for you, just as a wrestler, just every year, like coming into the ring with him going, oh my God, like, how have you come on this far in a year? Or how's the Joe Hendry experience been for you in the ring with him and seeing where he is now?
Just straight up, I couldn't be more proud of Joe, honestly. He is above and beyond and around about wrestling, one of my very best friends. We lived together at one point. He is someone that is, I don't say this lightly, but like right next to Demo is someone I consider a bit of a big brother, certainly through wrestling and in life. And just to get to see, like, because all the initial parody videos he did was actually filmed in the flat that he and I shared. And so, yeah, just to get to see that the years and years of hard work and frustration and like all-nighters and like to finally see it paying off in the way that he always saw that, I think it was hard, ironically, to get other people to believe in. I couldn't be happier for him. And long may it continue, genuinely.
So you saw the sausage being made, so to speak. did you go halfers on the colour printer? Was that, or I mean, I don't know if I want to get too into the weeds of how he produced these. Were you anyone in the particular videos? Were you roped in to be anyone?
I would very, very occasionally have to hold a camera or hold a light. Joe is very, like, if he's like this now, I would not be surprised. Joe is another one that he knows precisely what the Joe Hendry package is. He knows who his act is. And so he likes to know exactly that every element's getting done, how he likes it. And so, unless there is two people on camera, Joe is everyone that you're seeing in all his videos.
Yeah, I think that is a very common occurrence. That makes sense. Right, I'm definitely going to try and wrap up now. No, wait, ICW Zero-G Championship win, Phantom win in Liverpool. When you saw the reaction of people going, yeah, okay, cool, let's Lewis Girvan is Zero-G Champion, and then it was ripped away from you during that tour. Yeah, again, did that kind of help establish your thoughts of going, yeah, I'm pretty good at wrestling? People believe that, not to follow on from the Joe Hendry chat, but people believe in me that I can be Zero-G champion. Was that kind of a good moment for you to see?
So you're being generous saying it was as close to home as Liverpool. That was in Southampton. That was about as far away as possible. And the only reason I bring it up is because, like, we were very much not in ICW territory, you know, and the fact that we walk out and people knew who we were, and the fact that, you know, this venue I've never wrestled in and this town I've never been to came alive when it looked like I'd beat Lionheart for the title. That to me was such a real moment of, okay, I think we're really cooking here. I think we've got something good going. And that was my idea. The initial plan for the show that day was just for Lionheart to beat me, and that was going to be it. But he and I had wrestled a few times up until that point. He'd beat me twice, I'd beat him once. So I thought, okay, we kind of know what the plans are for the Hydro. How about we do this where it looks like I beat him and he'll give the belt back, so that way it can be two apiece. Maybe we can revisit this after the Hydro to maybe then like have that kind of rubber match. And selfishly, it was, I wanted to kind of show to the decision makers going, people seemed quite keen on the idea of me with a belt. People kind of, you know, seemed really, really keen there. It was really, really cool. Doubly so because it was in an area where it could have so easily played out to silence. And the fact that it didn't really made me go, okay, sweet, I think this is going to work.
Was that the Gibson RVD year? Was it?
That was the first year. So for at least for about 2 hours, it looked like I was going to be wrestling Ricochet for the Zero-G title, and the Stairway to Heaven ladder match was going to be more of a number one contenders affair before we switched it back, where on a technicality, Lionheart stole the belt back from me.
absolutely shocking. But it must have been great to be able to get a guy as I never really had a chat with Lionheart. I think I briefly saw him at shows. Still one of my biggest regrets is never saying hello to him at Abbey Anarchy 2019, it would have been. I kind of said hello, he walked past, and I think if I stopped him, we would have had a chat. But, you know, not to be. But yeah, it must be this 2 hour chat we've had and me going through your kind of body of work a little bit. I mean, this is only scratching the surface. I don't know if you're now sitting there just going, Jesus, I fit a lot in the 10 yeah. years I've been wrestling or so. Mm-hmm. But looking into the future, then, of course, we've got Bard 3 coming up with Arcade Violence. Are you just taking it as it comes now? You've went through your phases of wrestling and your body of work talks for itself. Is everything a bit of icing on the cake, or do you still have dreams, or are you working towards possibly trying to get that big bag, so to speak? That seems to be the vernacular nowadays for the kids. Working towards that big bag, whether it's WWE, AEW, Japan, what's your bucket list?
So I'm very much enjoying each match now. At one point it didn't look like I would get any more matches. So the fact that I do not take a single one of them for granted. But the most important thing to me is I think it's about time to make good on all the time and energy and effort other people put into me. I've said it about 50 times in this conversation, how fortunate I've been. The people who trained me, the peers who helped me, the international talent and legitimate legends that I've gotten to like rub shoulders with. And throughout it all, I've heard, you know, so many nice things about the potential I have. And I just think more than myself, I owe it to them to at least make a real good, honest go of making good on that potential and the time and effort that they gave me. I don't know what that looks like. I don't know if, you know, God forbid that was WWE or AEW or TNA or Japan or anywhere else, really. But if I can make a real good, honest go of making wrestling like the singular gig for myself, then I'd consider myself extremely blessed.
Wonderful.
And maybe, just maybe, I'll bring Fraser along with me.
Someone needs to carry the bags. We're definitely wrapping up. That's a nice point to drift towards the end here. If you want to plug anything, your socials, anything you want to plug between that's going out between now and August 19th is when this episode's going out, hopefully. So if there's anything you want to plug that's coming up, or yourself, by the way.
August 24th, Blockbuster Wrestling in the Asylum. I'm going one-on-one with my baby brother, Fraser. Let's see if he's gotten any better in the year and a bit since his debut match. Like you say, September 1st, Bard against Arcade Violence. September, I feel terrible.
First?
Respect. Pro Wrestling.
Oh, hang on, I'll help you this then.
Thank you so much.
Oh, now my computer's decided not to load. Hang on, we'll get there.
That's okay.
I've got a nice... If you go into swnscotland.com and then go down to the drop-down from promotions, there will be Respect. I've not put it on yet. There yet. That is very embarrassing for me.
No, that's okay. In my defense to anyone listening, 2 hours ago, I definitely had the date memorized.
Hang on. I'll use the handy search function on swnscotland.com. 14th September.
Thank you. 14th September, Respect Pro Wrestling are back. Respect Pro Wrestling, I think, over the years have done a really, really good job of giving opportunities of putting on really good family-friendly events in an area that at least certainly at that time didn't get lots of it. Genuinely so happy to see Respect back, and I will be wrestling Robbie Cardwell for the vacant Respect Pro title. So I'll hopefully be a 3-time Respect Pro champion in the next few weeks.
Wonderful. Well, perfect. And people want to find you on social media, they can do the work themselves. They can go and search for Lewis Girvan. That's how I found you. So that's how everyone else can do it as well. But wonderful. This has been so much longer, but I've definitely got work tomorrow. I don't know about yourself, but I need sleep. But this has been fascinating. Thank you very much for taking the time. And I'm glad that you're enjoying wrestling, and we've We spent the last 2 hours talking about it. Yeah. So
no, thank you very much for having me. If I could say a small thing, thank you for the work you do. You know, really kind of help supporting the scene. I'm a big believer in, like I said earlier, no one person can be wrestling. It's a communal effort, and you do a lot to really help build up and support a lot of the guys doing their thing.
Perfect. Well, oh, that's fine. 2 hours of making it all about you, and I'm chuffed because you made it about me right at the end. But perfect. Thank you very much.